I hope all of you have, or most of you have, heard about mixed method research, which is very recently gaining popularity in the domain of social sciences and humanities, also in management studies. So why mixed method? Why not qualitative research and why not quantitative research? Why not conventional method of research? Why should we deviate? Why should we think beyond the contemporary research approaches and research methods? What is the necessity? What are the compulsions? What are the challenges? So there are many facets. There are many facets. So I'll see how far I can do justice to this presentation today, because I will try my best to give you a comprehensive view so that at least you can have some, you know, cognitive clarity. This is the most important requirement for a researcher. Intelligence is there. Definitely you all are intelligent and you have a level of intelligence. Apart from this, as a researcher, you must have a very strong cognitive clarity so that you can do justice to your research and you can contribute to the field of knowledge and you can contribute to ultimate the social welfare and human well-being. During the course of presentation, if you find anywhere that there is a question coming to your mind, and if you think that this question needs to be answered then and there, then please do not hesitate. Ask me the question. I'll try to answer. If I find that question needs to be addressed at the end, so I'll tell you and then I'll take the question at the end during Q&A. Please read these three topics. These are indicative topics. Just please remember, after the presentation is over or sometime during the presentation, if I find suitable, then I'll open it and I'll ask you about your perception, your idea about the research methodology or approach. So just I have given three examples. So please try to remember it. And after we proceed with our presentation and discussion, we can discuss it, we may discuss it to understand what different types of methodologies or research approaches need to be utilized to execute these three different types of research or these three different topics. Okay, so just remember, there is no need to write anywhere in a piece of paper, no need to write, just read and remember. We'll discuss during the course of our presentation. See, when we say the social science perspective or humanities or applied social science, for example, sociology of health, then human behavior, social work practice, clinical psychology, there are so many other fields. So when we try to understand the behavior of a person, the behavior of a group, or the life pattern, the relationship pattern of functions, occupations, and different other issues of a community. So, as a social scientist, we need to consider the two basic components, that is the subject and the context. Subject and the context. So respondents, either individuals, groups, or communities, and their context, that is the situation. So if, as a researcher, if we do not consider both these components, our understanding will never be clear. So to develop a comprehensive understanding about a topic, about a subject, we have to include both the subject and the context in the study. And you all know very well, as a faculty member, as a scholar, you all know very well that when we conduct a survey, when we conduct a research using a questionnaire, when we conduct a research with a set of questions and set of objectives, it is very clear there that we often, most often, very often, we ignore the context and situation, because in survey or while we are using a questionnaire in our research to collect the primary data, we as a researcher are not involved in the process. We as a researcher are not effectively engaged in the process. Clear? So I'll discuss it. I'll help you to understand what I am telling. I'll just try to clarify so that you can understand the meaning and the application of each and every term, whatever I am using during this deliberation. So be it a survey research project, be it an empirical research project, yes, during experimental research design, definitely the researcher has to consider the situational aspects or the contexts. But in survey research, or when we use questionnaire, we circulate through Google or SurveyMonkey or different other platform, when you circulate it, we generally do not take into consideration the situations or the contexts. And then whatever understanding we reach in the form of conclusion, in the form of hypothesis testing, everything is based on statistics, everything might be based on some empirical logic or some statistical analysis, but those findings, those conclusions may be reliable in statistical sense or in the name of statistics, those could be reliable undoubtedly, but a big question can be raised: are those information, are those conclusions, are those inferences credible? Do they have credibility? Do they actually address the ground level realities? Do they actually address the nature of life people are having? Do they actually address the situation in which people are living? So this question is still not answered in the quantitative research, in the empirical research, in most of the experimental research also. So please keep it in mind that as a researcher, this is your basic social responsibility to take into consideration both the major components, the subject and the context, in the research process. Else, our understanding still remains incomplete, fractured, partial. Okay? This is the contemporary research process which we are currently engaged with. The research process with which we are currently engaged. Sorry, 1 minute. The research process which all of us, social scientists, anthropologists, okay, the scholars in social work research, sociology, psychology, in most of the social science disciplines, including management studies and other disciplines, our existing knowledge building process is faulty. It is full with flaws. Why? Because we begin our research journey with a set of perception. What we hear from our teachers, what we read from books, what we read from journals, So all the references we get from different other sources. This type of references, this type of information can build our perception. Okay, it can build our perception very effectively, nicely, but this is still a perceptual knowledge, not an actual knowledge. Because whatever we collect from books, from journals, from websites, through interaction with our teachers, everything, all our apratyaksha gyan. I'll come to Indian Indic science, I'll come to Indian Naya Shastra, I'll just give you a little reference so that it can sensitize you about the treasure we have in our shastras about social science research. So we do not have adequate knowledge when you start research process. We start with set of perceptions. So from perception we go and build assumptions, and from assumption we directly go to hypothesis. And when you have a set of hypotheses, we just design a questionnaire. Okay, we select certain statistical measures. We have a smart size of sample, and we do the analysis, and we test the hypothesis and draw a conclusion. So far as the scientific process of research is concerned, my thesis is approved, my thesis is qualified, and my thesis earns me or wins me a PhD degree. And the thesis goes to library, and then it is kept on a rack, and the thesis is lying there decades after decades without having any effective contribution to the life of people, to society, or to anything else. That means, I want to mean that 85% to 90% of our theses have actually no value for humanities, no value for our societies. Those are simply theses. Those do not add any value to our life. Now, if this is the situation, now UGC is talking about, AICT is talking about, ICSSR is talking about, Ministry of Education is talking about, all the scholars groups, faculty forums, professors associations, all over the world, now they are talking about in a different voice, in a different tune. Now they have realized that, okay, hundreds and thousands of theses being produced every year, and millions of research papers are published in journals with index numbers, with impact factor, everything is okay. But how far those actually contribute to transform the life of people, the situations in society? How far all those research could actually address the sustainability issues, futuristic issues in our society, in our life? So hardly 10% to 15% theses are really effective, and they contribute something to the world of knowledge and for the welfare of the humanity and society. So what do I want to mean here? That the contemporary research process, dominantly in the social science, management studies, humanities, are using deductive reasoning. Are using deductive reasoning. 80% students of a class have been found to be very good in their academic performance. Understand? This is the, for example, a conclusion of a research, that 80% students of a class, educational research, 80% students of a class have wonderful performance in every subject. So after that, when the conclusion is drawn, After that, whenever I go to principal's cabin, when I submit the research, there I find one student of a particular class, of that particular class, is sitting in front of the principal, and principal introduces the student to me that, see, he is Mr. Rahul, a student of class 9. I do not know Rahul, but based on my research conclusion, whatever just I have completed, and I have seen that more than 80% students' performance are fantastic, then immediately I jump into a conclusion further that Rahul is a student of class 9, so Rahul is also a good performer. So this is the implication of deductive research. This is the implication of deductive research, and this is the outcome of every survey research, what we do by using a questionnaire or by using a survey. So you can understand the contemporary process of research with which we are more or less involved, engaged, that does not substantially contribute any effective knowledge in the existing knowledge system. So what would be the alternative? That we have to find out. So in research, so the question is, you know, twofold. What is the nature of knowledge? Whether we are taking a set of theories and we are going ahead for theory testing. Understand? In most of the cases, when we have a set of objectives, we have done a very beautiful literature review, then we reach a set of hypotheses based on the assumptions, and then we decide what would be the means of knowing, what would be the means of investigation. So either we go ahead to conduct a survey. Survey might be through a structured interview schedule. See, again, there are limitations. I am not going into the detail of each and every tool, but I will give some hints so you have to catch it. Interview schedule, that is structured. And questionnaire, it is mostly structured. 99% questionnaires, the 99% content of the questionnaire must be structured. This is the theory. This is the rule. So the nature of knowledge, theories, and we are trying to see how far those theories are really addressing our current life, current situations. And for that, we choose different type of means, mostly survey, interviewing, okay, with a structured interview schedule and a questionnaire. So what we get? So we collect information for a large number of sample to satisfy the empiricism principle, because there is a question of validity and reliability. So to satisfy these two principles of statistics, so we have to go with empiricism. Okay, quantitative analysis. And we need to collect a large number of sample to ensure reliability and validity. Pre-testing, so many things are there we do. Fine. And what is the evidence? And what is the nature of that knowledge? That knowledge is deductive, and that knowledge is derived through statistical analysis. That knowledge is derived through statistical analysis, numerical analysis. Okay? But if, as a researcher, if I personally involve myself with the subject and the context, ethnography, narrative study, grounded theory, case study, phenomenology, these all different, five different methods of qualitative research, where researchers' participation and engagement is must. So researcher himself or herself observe, feel, understand, where the researcher can utilize all the five or six sense organs as a human being, as an analyst. As an analyst, we, the researcher, have to use all the five or six sense organs. Not only observation, not only listening, but also to feel, to realize, to sensitize. All those things together contribute to our cognitive process. The cognitive process means where the information is processed, the data is processed, and an understanding is built. And based on that understanding, we build our own knowledge. But the excessive dependence on scientism, the extensive or excessive dependence on the scientific research method or Western models, we are very much obsessive with the statistical or statistical analysis or quantitative analysis. So number decides the character of people, number decides the fate of people, number solves a problem, number finds out a solution. But life is always not an arithmetic. Life is not always an arithmetic. Life is not always, a statistical calculation. It is something beyond that. It is something beyond that. Because whenever it is a quantitative analysis, the democratic principle rules. That is majority principle. The majority principle determines the conclusion of a research. If the majority of people selling something, that becomes the reality. This is not the truth. This is a reality. But if 100%, if a family member consists of 10 persons, if I talk to all 10 persons, then I have a comprehensive understanding about that family. But if I draw 4 persons through some random sampling method, this is scientifically sound process. But the knowledge we derive, the understanding we derive, it is based on the majoritarian principle, calculations, analysis, statistical analysis, not an absorbed process of observation, not a process of observation and understanding where the researcher himself or herself participates, engages, understands, feels, and then processes the information. So that comprehensiveness is not available in quantitative research. That's why in most of the cases, the quantitative research, the empirical research studies, the contemporary research studies, whatever we are doing now, they are very popular. I'll tell why. They're very popular. Okay? So they help us a lot. And we comfortably complete our research project and submit the thesis and get our degrees, MPhil or PhD or whatever. But hardly they contribute substantially to the knowledge system, and they hardly carry something substantial which can transform the life of people or solve our real life problems. This is a simple model to understand the Indian Nyaya Shastra system. The Indian Nyaya Shastra system, you see, perception is a source of understanding which is followed by majority of people. When the student sitting in class listening to the teacher, that type of interaction in class, when we all are attentively listening to a teacher, do you think it builds your knowledge? This is not direct knowledge. You are getting an apratyaksha gyan or indirect knowledge. It is actually your perception. The teacher inspires you, helps you, facilitates you to understand a subject, and that builds your perception. Still, you do not have the knowledge. Even if people call it as a knowledge, it is an apratyaksha gyan. It is not actual knowledge. So you have to come down from perception to comparison. From comparison, you have to do inference. You have to draw inferences. You have to use words, that means variables, narratives, okay, interpretations, references, all those things you have to use, different type of artifacts, references of people, all those things you have to use to build a comprehensive understanding about the problem or about the subject. So if we start research with perception, and if we finish research with perception, as a researcher, we gain nothing. We do not have any direct knowledge, or which is called as pratyaksha gyan. We don't have. And Indian Nyayashastra categorically emphasizes that a researcher must have a pratyaksha gyan. That is experience. What is an experience? You do your analysis. From that analysis, you develop your insight. And from that insight, you build your own knowledge. And then you become a real researcher who contributes to the knowledge system and who contributes, who adds some value to the life of society and people. So, one thing is very clear, that perceptual knowledge, yes, it helps us. It facilitates us to do research. But if the entire journey of research, if we completely rely on our perceptual knowledge, then we do more danger than benefit in the name of research. I hope you all know what is inductive reasoning and deductive reasoning. What is deductive reasoning? A couple of minutes before I talk to you, what is deductive reasoning? Because most of the dominating field of social science research, the dominating field of social science research is empiricism, okay, empirical research, quantitative research, where we extensively use statistics. Through statistical analysis, we draw insights. And the majoritarian principle drives or determines the conclusion, the shape and the nature of conclusion. That is deductive knowledge. So I have given an example also. Okay, I hope it is clear to all of you, because all of you are very senior, all of you are most of you are faculty members and then doing your PhD studies. So this is my assumption, or this is my belief, that you all understand the difference between inductive knowledge and deductive knowledge, or inductive reasoning and deductive reasoning. If you, all of you know, then I proceed, else I'll take 5-7 minutes time to discuss the difference between these two reasoning process. So let us have a quick view. So let us see first the deductive process, so that you all are very much popular. This is popular amongst you, and I hope many of you, those who are present here today in this particular session, are definitely following this method of research. First, you define your problem. You develop a problem definition. Then you do review of existing literature, theories, and from there you draw some insights, some assumptions you have in your mind when you go through and read lot of research literature. And from there you develop some hypothesis, because you have a set of objectives, Your research goal is very clear. Your research goal is very clear. You want to see whether education and poverty has a relationship or not. You want to see whether Indian culture is non-supportive to preventive COVID practices. Why lakhs of people are noticed to have COVID infection every day? Hundreds and thousands of people are dying. So somebody, a social scientist can, after reading some newspapers, after reading some research papers, can develop some assumptions that might be our culture is not adaptive to or responsive to the preventive COVID practices. So people feel uncomfortable. People feel those are not so important. So people have different other priorities. So there is a kind of deficiency in culture in terms of its, you know, responsiveness to the preventive measures of COVID. So see, all those things we are thinking, sitting on our table, reading some books, some journals, some research papers, some newspapers, or listening a couple of people on social media, blogs and all. So very limited, very, very limited, very, very narrow view. With using that, we develop hypotheses, and then we build a questionnaire or our tool. Then we go for observation, that is data collection. They do analysis and we draw a conclusion. Our research is done. PhD is over. PhD awarded. But whether that particular PhD, does that really contribute something? Something substantial, something new? I do not know. Because there are hundreds and thousands of questions being attached, being raised against deductive reasoning or against deductive method of research, which we all are comfortable with. What is inductive reasoning? What is inductive reasoning? Here, we do not start with any existing theory. We are postgraduates. We have studied our subject extensively. We are very good scholars. We have a passion for research. So I know all of us have studied different theories. It's okay, but I do not want to arrest my thought process with some established or existing theories. I read theories. I understand theories. I try to understand the situation by or through the inputs of a theory. It is true, but society, time, everything is very dynamic. Nothing is static. Even a theory has been built 15, 20 years back, may have lost its relevance in today's world. So why research is called? It is a continuous process. So the theories which have been built 100 years back, Maslow's need hierarchy theory, many of us know those who are in social science, especially in management studies, social work, all of you must be knowing this theory. Can you really believe that a theory which was 100 years back, which was developed by Abraham Maslow, still have a relevance? May have a relevance 10%, 20%. May have its relevance to a particular section of group of people, may have its relevance to a particular profession or occupation, but Abraham Maslow's need hierarchy theory may not be the absolute theory which has the potential to define, to describe, to explain the entire gamut of motivation as a subject in different disciplines. No, it has limitations. So as a researcher, when I start my research process, I should not be arresting my thought process, or I should not surrender my thought process to any particular theory or theories. I'll be keeping my eyes and ear open. I will listen, I'll read, I'll observe. I'll build my own philosophy. I'll build my own assumption. I'll do some preliminary exploration. And then I may go and do a review of existing theories. Definitely. So from the observation, definitely I'll try to find out some pattern of behavior, some pattern of behavior among people. Clear? So I'll try to understand the behavior of a small group of students in a class. I'm not addressing the 100 students of a class. I'm not thinking to take 35, 40 samples by using random technique, but I am selecting 4-5 students of that particular class, and I am engaging myself in depth. I am sitting with them, I am eating with them, I am moving with them, I am walking with them. So I am completely engaged with my subject and context. I am interacting with them in their own social settings. I'm not just using some questionnaire. I'm not just giving some questionnaire, asking them, please fill it. I am trying to understand their problem. I'm trying to understand their life in their own situations. And from there, I am trying to develop my insights. I'm trying to understand and identify different factors, different variables, which are determining, shaping, driving, moving their lives. I'm not hunting variables from research paper. I'm not reading 10 research papers. The researches which have been done in UK or Singapore or Malaysia or USA. Maybe I am doing some research. I am reading some research papers where the scholars have done their work in India. But if some scholars have done some research in Jammu and Kashmir, and I am sitting in Rajasthan, Jaisalmer, University of Rajasthan, University of Bikaner, University of Udaipur. Some researches have been conducted in the, high altitude, some village hamlets or some, small communities. Somebody have done some research, and those factors, those variables, I am taking as the variables for my research, and I am doing my research in Jaisalmer, Rajasthan, or a slum in a Calcutta, or a rural district in West Bengal or Bihar or Odisha. Just let me know, tell me very honestly, whether those variables or those factors might be the problem looks like similar. It's a question of poverty, unemployment, okay? Youth's motivation for social entrepreneurship or other form of entrepreneurship. So do you think the factors in Jammu Kashmir and the factors in West Bengal are same? No. We are living in a highly diverse society. We principally accept it as a researcher. We principally accept that India is a highly diverse society. But why every time we try to standardize our research? In the name of review literature, there is a standardization. In the name of framing tools, there is a standardization. In the name of selecting statistical analysis, there is a standardization. Everything is standardized. Research is not exempted. It has become a process. It has become an arithmetic process. Simple. A defined method with a defined problem statement, with a defined methodology. So what is it? Is it a production process? Is research a production process? Like what is going on in different industries, car manufacturing industries, bottling plant, LPG plant, dairy milk plant, food processing industry. The current or contemporary research has been turned into information or data processing process, where we mechanically collect some data, we process it, and we reach a product. That is the thesis or conclusion. Research is not a manufacturing process. Research is not a production process. Research is a process which itself evolves. Research is a process which must itself evolve. If we do not satisfy this principle, then we are doing injustice to research. Whether we are in sociology or psychology or other social science or social work or management studies, we are doing injustice. There are certain exceptions for the scholars, those who are in history. Definitely there are some exemptions because it's a different subject. Social science, obviously, but it's a different subject. But education, sociology, industrial sociology, industrial psychology, social work, okay, organization behavior, human resource management, customer behavior, so many areas. Things are changing so fast. Situations are so dynamic that often, most often, very often, deductive method misleads the research findings. I am telling this with authority. I am telling this with confidence. I am not pulling down the contemporary process, the deductive process, the survey method. I am not pulling down. They have their own scope and they have their own limitations. They have their own importance. They have their own implications. As a researcher, as a scholar, our moral responsibility, our ethical responsibility is something different. Our responsibility is to do justice to the subject. Our moral responsibility is to our people, to our society, to the subject itself. How much we contribute, that is important. Okay, so what is inductive reasoning? So I closely observe and monitor the behavior of one or two bank employees of a particular bank of a particular branch of, you know, bank. And I find both the employees are excellent in their customer relationship skills, excellent customer relationship skills. So I studied only two employees through close observation by being engaged with them. Okay. Without having any set of objectives, exploratory study to understand their life experience, to understand their work experience through their narratives. So this is a narrative study. Through their narrative, not through my questions. In most of the cases, what happens, you know, the researcher sits in library, defines the problem. Listen to me very carefully. Yeah? What I am telling it is very important. They define the research problem. Problem belongs to rural poor people. Problem belongs to the rural poor people. Problem belongs to self-employed women, microfinance. Who defines the problem? Researcher. Who defines the objective? Researcher. Who defines the factors? Researcher. And what is their source of knowledge? All references. References. Researches conducted in UK, USA, Singapore, Malaysia, Middle East, Europe, also India. Okay. But do they really have that reliability and credibility as inputs to shape my research? I do not know. That is a huge, you know, question. So, as a researcher, I do not have a set of theory in my mind. I do not have a set of goal which I have to achieve. No, I do not have. I am just trying to understand the problem. I am just trying to understand the phenomena. So, I have started reading books. I have started talking to people. I have started visiting places. So I am building assumptions. From assumption, I am exploring, observation, coming close to my subject, talking to them, interacting with them, engaging with them, and understanding their life in their words. And when I come to know that these two employees of the bank are really excellent in their customer relationship, are excellent, you know, in their customer relationship, their service, you know, attitude towards service is excellent. So is it possible for you to tell that since these two bank employees have been found to be excellent in their customer relationship, in their behavior, so majority of the employees of that bank are equally excellent? No. It is very, very difficult to draw such conclusion in inductive reasoning. We cannot. But in deductive reasoning, just opposite, and it is very easy, because majority principle determines, democratic principle determines. So I am safe. Science supports me. Science supports me. Logic supports me. I am safe. I am playing safe as a researcher there. But here, the inductive research, inductive reasoning, the researcher takes huge risk. Risk means he's actually having the passion to understand the truth. A researcher here plays the role of a Satyan Nesi, Bomkes Boksi, if you know. I am investigating the truth. I am not jumping in to define it as a reality. Reality may be different than the truth. What is happening now in the COVID scenario? The truth and reality mismatch. So I am not going into that. It may divert my attention, so I'm not going into that. So the question is it possible, if the deductive methods have limitations, how to overcome those limitations? How to build a comprehensive understanding about my problem, about the people, about their situation, so that we can really understand the situation and we can really understand a workable solution, a feasible solution of different social issues. Okay? So the basic premise is the researcher has to participate in the research. Research is a participatory process, but most of us are engaged in non-participatory research. Sitting in home, sitting in library, we mostly complete our PhD or doctoral researches. We never engage ourselves in the, you know, data collection process. We never let ourselves to be absorbed in the situation. If we are not absorbed in the situation, all our sense organs do not function. If all our sense organs do not function, we cannot develop, we cannot do an effective cognitive analysis. And if we cannot do an effective cognitive analysis, our analysis is incomplete. And incomplete analysis leads to a fragile insight, incomplete insight. And with that, if we claim to develop some research, it is dangerous. So let us go to the next slide to understand. Yes. So very briefly, I'll just conclude here this particular part. So what I have been talking, let me give a pause for 5 minutes and go back to the participants. All of you are silently listening. Am I reaching all of you?
Yes sir.
Okay. Okay, please. So because there is no noise, so it a print of silence, so I do not know whether I am reaching you, whether you are really understanding it or not. So there is always a kind of no gap remains when you interact on the online platform. If it is a classroom platform offline, then I can impromptu, I can do an interaction with all of you, and then I can come to know your difficulties. But here it is not possible. So sometimes it appears that I am just talking. I am just talking in front of a dark forest. Nobody is there and I am talking.
No, sir. It is going well, sir. You are okay. Critically analyze the current situation of the research process and
different
methodology. Okay.
So,
Dr. Goswami.
Yes.
Yeah, this is Aparajita. I actually raised hand. I had a question on the inductive reasoning system.
Please tell me.
So if you can go back to the slide, I just want to refer the slide. And my question is on both these two slides.
Okay.
Inductive. When both, in fact, deductive as well as inductive.
Yes, tell me the question, please.
Like when we were discussing about inductive reasoning, you said that saying the present scenario and this complexion of the society in which we are supposed to conduct.
Your voice is breaking. So can you just check it? You just maintain little gap between your system and your lips. Hello, Aparajita. Hello. Okay, please keep your question with you. We'll discuss little later because I cannot hear your voice. So I think there is some problem at your end. So please keep your question. We'll discuss definitely in some time later. Okay. So let us move a little forward. So I was here. So what I was talking, so the contemporary process, what we are all doing now, see, we are using foreign literature, okay, mostly foreign literature, does not mean 100% foreign literature. Definitely we have indigenous literature too, mostly old data. We are doing research in 2021 and we cite references of 1978, 1950s, 1940s, 1980s, irrelevant. Unless until it is a very core issue, very fundamental issue, we cannot cite so old references. Understand? So we have to, if it is applied research, very important, if it is an applied research, then definitely we have to restrict our observations in the observations only with last 4 to 5 years research literature, not beyond that. But if it is a fundamental research, core pure theoretical research, then we can do a historical review also, so we can go back 10, 50, 60 years back, no issue. So you see the situation, we had our dependence mostly on foreign literature, old data and residual reviews, no contextualization. Okay, what I refer as apratyaksha gyan. Problem is framed, not defined. Problem is framed or problem is defined. That means the researcher defines the problem statement. With this, our journey begins. So we start with a misapprehension, and that is called ajnana. With that, we proceed further. It develops dosha, that is distorted views. Research I am doing scientifically. Objectives are there, hypotheses are there, statistics also nicely identified. Everything I have done scientifically, everything is correct. But I am moving with, I am traveling with some distorted views. Then my activity, my analysis, everything I do complete, and then last, but not the last, what happens, I draw a conclusion and I build some recommendations or whatever, I submit my thesis. I may be getting PhD, but that thesis is only an element or object to be kept on the rack without having any substantial use. And that is the most suffering part. Or if you fail to capture the track of your research, you have a very, very suffering, painful end. That your thesis, your research is lingering on. Instead of 3 years, it is going on, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 12 years. Why does it happen so? It happens so because we are not on the right track. In most of the cases, it happens. And what else? I'll just share with you one research paper. So I'll give it, I'll share it with Dayashankar, and I'll request Dayashankar to give it to everybody, those who are doing PhD at least. You all must read that research paper to understand. I have done a review of 16 PhD theses which have awarded PhD to the scholars. The theses which have awarded PhD to the scholars from a particular NAC A grade university in Tamil Nadu. And I have done a critical review where I found all 16 theses are having a lot of flaws. They are disqualified to award PhD degree. So that I have done a critical review paper, and I have published it with, you know, one Scopus journal. So I'll share it with Dayashankar. I'll ask him to share with all of you, and I'd be happy if you read that and come back to me for your with your questions and queries. So next one, this is the major drawback. Already I have discussed with all of you that the primary data is collected through responses. Responses means what? What my respondent, I sample, that they respond to certain questions. Questions made by me. And I just take the questions to them, they respond. My understanding is based on only responses, not observation, not realization, not feeling. No other senses involved. Obsession for positivist approach largely ignores naturalistic constructivist approaches. So that is actually come from qualitative research. So that particular part is grossly missing in deductive research or empirical research. Lack of point of reference. Knowledge formation is not validated with prevailing truth. Understand? Or vice versa. So we try to understand a social scenario. We try to understand a social situation through statistical analysis, through numerical analysis. Okay? Not through a naturalistic process. That's why there are many scholars and authors who refer qualitative research as a naturalistic research. They refer it. They do not refer quantitative research as naturalistic research, but they call and they refer qualitative research, mixed method research, as naturalistic research. Reliability as an operational principle. So where we extensively use the standardization, understand? Standardization of tools, everything you all know. So standardization, the principle of standardization rules our research. The problem. This is the solution. This is the solution. Then we'll enter into the next part very quickly. So what is the solution? Survey generates only peripheral information, not insight. But we need to develop insight. So when you need to develop insight, we have to engage ourselves in the entire process. Plus, data also required. We are not ignoring the importance of data. We are not ignoring the empirical, the power of empiricism. We never ignore the power of quantitative analysis, statistical analysis. So can we combine these two? If we can combine these two, we have very effective insight, and that leads us towards wisdom that every researcher must develop. That is the jnana, that is your knowledge, wisdom. When we have wisdom, when we have actual knowledge, you can write papers after papers after papers after papers. Why people struggle to write papers, research papers? Because they do not have jnana. They do not have anything solid inside them. I hope if you do a kind of introspective analysis post session today and later, you will definitely understand the value of what I am talking now. And then what happens when you have the wisdom, your own jnana, actual knowledge, then the delusion disappears. You are the master of your own research process. You just go and consult with your guide. You do not extensively depend on him. And this is one of the major drawbacks of Indian PhD system. The research scholars find themselves helpless in front of their supervisors. The supervisors exploit, the supervisors deprive, mislead, misguide. In some cases, there are some cases of exploitation too, because you are excessively depending on them. But if you follow this process, you have your confidence and you can guide your own research with minimal intervention, with minimal help of your research supervisor. Okay, so here, this particular part, I will not go detail, because this is the Nyaya Shastra given by Gautama. What they say, this you have to read little bit, you have to do some self-study. It is very difficult to, you know, give a concise view or comprehensive view now about the Nyaya Shastra. It is very difficult, but I suggest all of you to read little bit whatever is available on net to understand the Indian treasure, the Indian literature. Our darsana, what is Indian philosophy? It is based on Lakshmana Karanam, you know. The Western philosophy and Indian darsana are different. What is darsan? Darsan means pratyaksha gyan, where the master experiences the situation. Okay, our lineage, our linkage with the universe, our munis and rishis and saints, they had a pratyaksha gyan. They understood the realities. So you will find most of the modern scientific innovations have been inscribed in Vedas. It is established worldwide that Indian Vedic literature is full of science, or it is a scientific text. And that is based on darsana, not Western, not as it is said in Western philosophy. That is darsan philosophy, but ours is darsana, not philosophy. It is, you know, Lakshmana Karanam. Okay, that is the pratyaksha gyan. So I'm not going into that. So there are different, it has a different steps and processes. You can understand discipline of logic, science of argument, science of reasoning, rationality, okay? All those things guide the research process. So this, I just want to skip this. And then this is not so important now, because this you can do. These are 16 process, the critical inquiry, the methodology, or the research actually, as a critical inquiry, a research must follow the 16 processes, the 16 steps. So, okay, I'll just ask you a question after a couple of more slides. I'll just ask you a question, because there is a lot of misconception among the scholars about the difference of research objectives and research question. So there is a huge misconception. So that we'll see after one or two more slides. I'll come back to that question and discuss. This is also not required now. Yeah, come here to understand, and then we'll understand the logic behind mixed method research, and then different types of mixed method research. See, as I told you, that our contemporary research method, because it gives us a very beautiful, a very comfort zone. We all, the researchers, feel very comfortable. Okay. We have a goal set, because we have a set of objectives to understand the demographic pattern of the respondents, to understand their income and expenditure pattern. To see, all I decide, the problem I try, the problem I define, the variables I identify, factors I define, and I identify as a researcher, and I set the goal, and then I go to the respondent. So I fix the frame. Frame means problem, objectives, hypothesis, statistics, analysis, conclusion. Everything is framed, and I know I'm going to reach there. And what is the nature of knowledge? Apratyaksha gyan. The nature of knowledge is deductive knowledge based on majoritarian principle. So what is the, what are the characteristics of this type of research? What we are currently doing? It is called ethic research, that is non-participatory. Content-oriented, adoption, theory, adoption, theory, different type of theories we take and we go ahead with the theoretical review, hypothesis formulation, testing. Problem is framed, communication, okay? What is communication? We communicate with respondents. We do not engage ourselves in dialect. We do not engage ourselves in conversation, but we communicate. Sir, aapko ye, I am just sending you some questionnaire, kindly respond. Okay? We communicate. We do not involve in conversation, dialect. Survey is very popular. We use survey method of research mostly. Randomization, positivist, manipulative. When it is statistics, manipulative. Oh, theek hai. How much sample you have taken? Sir, 75. 75, what is the result? Sir, this is the result. You make it 70 and see what happens. Take it, make it 60 and see what happens. Make it 40 and see what happens. So there are a lot of manipulation is there. Analysis, explanation, confirmation. Analysis, we do analysis, statistical analysis, quantitative analysis, we explain, we confirm. That is common conclusion. Reliability, validity testing, statistical measures. So ultimately we reach theory testing. So this process is going on and going on and going on, repetitive research in the name of repetitive research, because whatever method is scientific, you can repeat it, replicable. Okay, if it is not replicable, it is not scientific. That is what the Western philosophers tell us. We cannot ignore. It is okay. It is right. Definitely it is right. But what do you mean by replicable process? Somebody has done a research 15, 20 years back and the same thing I replicate today without adapting it to the modern context, current situation. What would be the value of that research? Only theory testing. And theory testing, in theory testing process, we grossly overlook the current contexts. Okay, now let us see the next. These are explanatory. I'm not going into this. Now, this is the non-conventional zone. Non-conventional zone means I am asking you to think about an alternative process, a qualitative research process, a qualitative research process, and then followed by a quantitative research process. I'll tell you that also. I'll make it clear to all of you. Don't worry. So non-conventional zone, or we are talking about an alternative method. We are talking about a qualitative research followed by a quantitative research. So first we do a qualitative research, then we do quantitative research. First, we develop a theory. Theory should evolve, understand? We are not talking about theory of 100 years back or 60, 70 years back. All those feminist theories today's 50 years old, 30 years old feminist theories today, these are all irrelevant. We need to develop feminist theories in today's context. But we are not doing. Okay, so question is, let us build our theory and then go for its testing. Let us not take existing theories and simply just let us not take the existing theories and jump into analysis and conclusion. That is deductive method. Let us not do that. Quantitative research. Let us develop our theories and then go for testing it. So first I do quantitative research, qualitative research, then I go for quantitative research. Why qualitative research first? Logic are there. Why? It is called emic process, means the researcher participates in the research process. And I told you the benefits of participation. Your all sense organs are involved in data collection and analysis. Contextualization, that is adaptation, is there important. Everything is determined by the context. In management studies, you know, one principle is very, very important and very relevant. They say contingency theory or contextuality in management studies. In management studies, one theory is very familiar, very, very famous. That is called situational decision making, situational leadership, and situational problem solving. Situational problem solving, or sometimes it is called free market-based rational decision-making process. We are living in a free market society. So free market-based rational decision-making society. Okay, so adaptation, context is important. Context rule the process. Context rule the process. Researcher is involved, engaged. So this is exactly talking about qualitative research process. Interaction, dialectical. We do not communicate, we interact with the respondents. We engage with dialects, a very close, deep conversation. I'll tell you the reason, you will understand. Problem defined. Problem is defined along with problem defined means one. I am just seeking the meaning of the problem. I am talking to the people. I am not defining the problem sitting in library or lab. I am defining the problem after interacting several interactions with the people, understanding their perspectives. And then I am trying to define the problem. I am not framing the problem. Problem framing and problem and defining problem are two different concepts. Triangulation is there. What is triangulation? A beautiful concept. Triangulation. What is triangulation? Okay, I am doing analysis, a company report analysis. Then I am conducting a survey, and then I am conducting an interview also. I am conducting interview, I am conducting a survey, and I am referring the reports of the company. Triangulation. And then cross verification, triangulation, data verification, reliability and validity of data, not through statistical process but through cross verification. That gives you more confidence, that gives you more clarity than simple statistical analysis. Naturalistic, heuristic, and constructivist. This is the approach in qualitative research. Naturalistic, heuristic, constructivist. Your insights, your intuition helps you more than drawing insight through arithmetic or statistics or numbers. Exploration, description, synthesis, credibility, usefulness, theory formulation. So what is the objective of qualitative research? Theory formulation. Qualitative research is not a conclusive research. Qualitative research is not a conclusive research, but empirical research, survey research, experimental design, okay, empirical research, descriptive research, all are conclusive research. That means at the end of research, we draw a conclusion which can be generalized, which can be applied to a larger section of people. The insight drawn through a smart sample, the conclusion arrived, can be generalized. But a qualitative research does not end with a conclusion. It is not a conclusive research, but it develops your insights. It develops your critical understanding about a situation. It helps you to identify different factors, variables responsible for a problem. So you can build a theory. Now, when a theory is built through qualitative research, you take it further, do a quantitative research. After that, so you satisfy the principle of mixed method research, a qualitative research, and then followed by a quantitative research. So that is really, really it gives you a lot of weightage. It gives you a lot of confidence. You as a researcher will always feel proud of it, your own work, that what I have done. You will get appreciation from across the globe when you publish a paper. People will cite your paper. People will cite your work in their research projects. So this is the same thing, comparison. I'm not going into that. Why qualitative research? Why mixed method? The subject we deal with, that is the human beings. You know, whatever we see, it is only the tip of iceberg. Those who are in social work, social science, psychology, they, I think they are all very much familiar with this model or with this concept. Others, the students, the faculty members, the scholars, those who are from history and geography and other disciplines may not be knowing this particular model. If you know, it is fantastic. If you do not know, please study this model. So whatever we see in naked eyes, for example, a simple observation, whatever we see, it is called the tip of iceberg. Okay, one third, we can see the one third. The two third of human behavior, it is hidden. Sentiments, feelings, attitude, prejudices, understand? Preferences, choices, values, morals. See, all those together form the opinion of a respondent. Yes or no? But you know, we never give importance to that. We just use a survey method. We send the question to the respective respondent, and the respondent, they respond. We do not know how they are responding, when they are responding, where they are responding to your question. While they are traveling in a train, while they are sitting in a restaurant, while they are taking their dinner, are they serious when they are filling the questionnaire? Whatever information you are getting through questionnaire, are they valid? Lot of questions are there, lot of limitations. But the one thing which provides safeguard, that is scientism, a scientific method. Method is correct, it's a good research. If the method is correct, it may not be a good research. It may be a good research in terms of its process, but it may be a bad research in terms of its contribution and contribution and credibility. Because human behavior or human or social culture, it is a very vast subject. We cannot simply map the culture or behavior by just framing 10-15 questions. It is only residual information, a residual understanding, does not contribute anything substantial, anything comprehensive. So what is the hidden agenda? What is the hidden motive? What is the hidden behavior, customs, values, traditions, you know, prejudices, preferences, choices, lot of things. So about the respondent, those things only we can explore if we engage ourselves with conversation, with dialect. The human mind has three layers: conscious, subconscious, and unconscious. And you know, 80-85% of our behavior is a product of subconscious mind. And subconscious mind is not the actual personality. It differs because in psychology it has a value, it has a scope, but when it is a social science, whenever you are doing some research on very sensitive issue, so the adult inside the respondent should respond. The adult person inside the respondent should respond. That means the conscious mind should respond. The conscious mind, whatever it responds, the actual response. The subconscious mind responds. It may not be the actual response. It is not the actual, behavior or actual motive. So there is a lot of differences between the conscious state of mind and subconscious state of mind. So if a respondent is filling your questionnaire, you ensure that the subconscious mind or unconscious mind is responding to the questionnaire. But when you engage with them, you can understand who is speaking. The subconscious mind is speaking, or unconscious mind is speaking in the respondent. So you have to do this engineering during the process of dialect, during the process of interview. You can bring him to the conscious level, and then you have to ask the critical questions to get the credible information. Very important. So this is the rational which determines, which establishes the use of mixed method, which establishes the importance of qualitative research to understand our people, to understand our problem, to understand our society, our culture. That's why there is a research in qualitative method, ethnography. Ethnography, understanding people's culture through their words, their narratives, their activities, their interactions, their practices, their value systems, their functions. I just go there and engage myself and observe and observe and observe to understand a culture which is shared by a group of people, a tribal village. A tribal village. What is their culture? I have to do ethnography. I cannot understand a tribal culture by conducting a survey. How do you know the in-depth culture of a tribal community? How do you know that you are setting some objectives and you are framing 25 questions? Are you sure that those 25 questions completely define and completely cover the entire culture of the tribal community? How do you know that? So this is, I say, this is a kind of, it is a kind of audacity on the part of a researcher. We should not do that. If we are really doing something, if we are really understanding the issues and problems of tribal women, we have to do ethnography. We have to do case study, depending on the nature of case, nature of problem, or we have to do narrative study. Depending upon the nature of the problem, we have to choose a combination of methods. So there are two different types of method we'll see. These are the five different qualitative research, there are three types of mixed method research. I just tell you very briefly, three types of mixed method research: qualitative followed by quantitative, first category. Second category, first quantitative, then qualitative. Okay, I am taking an old theory, I am following the contemporary method, that is deductive research method, that is descriptive research design or empirical research design. Then I reach a conclusion. Before I reach a conclusion, whatever statistical analysis finds, that I want to validate through qualitative investigation. So I want to find out whether the statistical analysis, the findings through statistical analysis, and the findings through qualitative analysis, whether they match or there is a gap. If the gap is very wide, then there is something wrong. And mostly you will find that your quantitative method, whatever you have adopted, might have been wrong. Okay? So there are a lot of other critical issues which we are not talking here. So three types of mixed method research, based on your requirement, based on the nature of problem. So where first category is, first it is qualitative and then quantitative. First you build theory and then go and test the theory, draw a conclusion. Second category, you go with deductive method, go with quantitative method or empirical method or descriptive research design. draw a conclusion. Okay, so you have to find out that interface, whether exactly after conclusion you will do qualitative research or sometime you will do simultaneously, that you have to decide. That is a very technical thing, and it this kind of decisions generally you do not decide. The decisions itself evolves. The situation will tell you what you should do, because we do not know. Like deductive research, descriptive research, we know the result, what is going to happen. Either it is going to be accepted or rejected. Simple. Everything is set. Goal is set. But here I do not know what is going to be evolved. What is the discovery? I do not know. Let follow the process. Let use a very beautiful approach. Let's go through naturalistic process and see what happens. So a theory is built, an understanding is built, and then we may go further and test the theory. Okay. First, second category. First, you do quantitative research, then you check its validity. Okay, this is what my conclusion is. This is what my conclusion is drawn. But is it really applicable to society? Let us go and see its validity. Is it relevant? What is the ground reality? Let us go and see. And you may find that still there is a gap. The conclusion you have drawn through quantitative research and the understanding or insights you have drawn through qualitative investigation, you may find differences or gaps. So that's the second category. Third, both will go simultaneously. I'll go interview method or extensive qualitative research with a small sample size, and on the other side I'll go ahead with a quantitative research design. The two processes will go simultaneously. The three major categories of mixed method research. And then another type, we say that multiple research method. The multiple research method generally we use in qualitative research. It may be a combination of narrative research and grounded theory. It may be a combination of ethnography and case study. It may be a combination of narrative research and phenomenology. So to understand the best possible combinations, you have to read number of research papers in this domain, in the qualitative research domain, and then you will understand when such decisions are taken. Generally it happens, generally most of the cases the problems are critical, situations are critical. Okay, so it is not a single method can answer all questions. So in most of the time you will find that either it is a multiple research, or you will find the situation demands for a mixed method research. Okay, so already I have discussed to all of you this definition. These are the questions. They are the dimensions of qualitative research. These you all can read later, no issue. No, it is not so important now to discuss here. They are the different typologies. Yes, these three types also I told you. One is qualitative. Okay, when just I repeat here, the first category, when qualitative is the dominant method, that means first you are doing qualitative method. And now I'll go to those three research questions. First, you briefly see these three different methods of mixed method research. Qualitative dominant, that means first qualitative, then quantitative. Second, quantitative is dominant, the first quantitative method, followed by qualitative method. And then area around center, that means the qualitative quantitative continuum, together they go. Together they go. I side by side I am carrying out both the method to understand a common problem. Problem is same. The research problem what I have is the same. So I am doing a group of researcher doing qualitative research, for example, or the same group of researcher doing quantitative research this way. So I am going to that first three question, first three research project, whatever I framed. So I am taking you there, and then I am asking you, please tell me for topic one, students' awareness about effectiveness of using N95 masks and hand sanitizer to contain COVID-19. This is a research project. Okay? This is a research project. Might be this has given to you by a government department, Department of Education. So please tell me which research method will be aptly suitable to execute this research topic. Please tell me. Then after you respond to this question, then we'll discuss briefly about difference between research objective and question. What research method you will use for the first topic, where your research goal is fixed, that you want to understand the level of awareness among the students about using N95 mask and hand sanitizer to contain COVID-19. What you will do? What research method you will use? आप लोग चुप बैठे रहेंगे, क्वेश्चन मैं ही करूं, मैं जवाब दूं, आमी बोलबो की उत्तरटा
सर, आई थिंक
सर,
यस यस, टेल मी व्हिच,
आई थिंक आई शुड गो फॉर अ क्वांटिटेटिव मेथड इन दिस काइंड ऑफ
क्वांटिटेटिव मेथड, यस, आई विल डू सर्वे ओनली
क्वांटिटेटिव. So the idea is that we may conduct an awareness campaign with the children, and before that we can be survey the baseline behavior of the children, and then we can also take an inline behavior of the children and put them into a matrix and understand that how often they are wearing mask and using sanitizer.
Yes.
If there is a positive increase, that means the impact is positive.
No, that is okay, but question is, when this is the topic makes it very clear that, see, your goal is fixed. You are going to assess the level of awareness of a group of people about something. The goal is fixed. Objective research, conclusive research. I can have a set of questions with me, because N95 mask, I know experts have already prescribed the effective use of N95 mask. That means how to use the masks is already published document. Nothing to explore here. The researchers, the scientists, they have told us that these are the ways we have to follow to use N95 mask. And this is the process of sanitizing hands. So I have a set of rules which I have to convert into a, you know, questionnaire or a checklist. And then I have to take it to the respondents, and I have to take their response. I have to take their response, and based on responses, with a number of sample, again the majority principle will be applied. If 80% people say they know the use of N95 mask and hand sanitization process, we will say, sir, my population is safe, because more than 80% people, students, they know how to use N95 mask and how to do the sanitization of hands. So I need not to do a qualitative research here. I can go ahead, directly I can go ahead and do a survey research, a quantitative analysis. Simple. What about the next one? Energy consumption pattern and affordability of tribal groups spread over 57 clusters in Union Territory of Ladakh. Tell me. Energy consumption pattern among tribal people, those who are living in Ladakh in altitude, and they are living not in a huge community but in clusters in different pockets of Ladakh. So can I do a survey here? Do I really know? How do they define energy consumption? Do I really know what they mean about energy? Do I know? Is there any literature available? Even if there is some literature available, that might have been applied or done on some other community, in some other place. Their contextual situation, their geophysical conditions, their economic conditions, their cultural background might be different. So I can use that study as a reference, but I cannot simply replicate that study because that study may not fit into this context. So here I do not know actually what I need to do. So I cannot set a group of objectives here. I cannot frame research objectives. Here I can have some research questions. Research questions. The energy consumption pattern among the tribal people. Just imagine, I do not know. This is a phenomenon which I do not know, which is not well published or which is not well documented. So I have to explore. I have to use inductive reasoning first. I have to understand and build the theory first. I have to go and do ethnography. I have to be in that village. I have to go and stay with them to understand the consumption pattern of electricity during morning, afternoon, evening, and night. Consumption pattern of electricity during their festivals, family functions. So many things are there. So if I do not participate in their life, if I do not become a member of their community. So I'm not talking about directly member. I'm not talking about you just go and get married with some lady or someone in that community and then do research. No. But you be part of their life. You engage yourself, observe them, interact with them, live with them, and then only you can really understand their energy consumption pattern. It's not so easy. I cannot just have a set of pre-decided variables and factors in my mind, which I have harvested through review literature, and I cannot simply design some objectives and hypotheses and do research. Useless study it will be. So I have to do qualitative research first, to understand and then develop a theory. What is tribal consumption pattern of energy? Build a theory. And then you do it in one or two clusters, qualitative research. Then if there are 57 clusters, then after qualitative research, after you develop theory, after you develop hypothesis, you now draw sample, because now you have variables, factors, everything. Now you design a deductive research or descriptive research or quantitative study, empirical research you do. And then you draw a conclusion. That research will definitely have immense value. What is the third one? Designing a work culture to accommodate diverse groups of employees at a software development firm in Bangalore. Tell me, work culture. Again, understanding work culture of a software development firm in Bangalore.
So this should be qualitative.
Yes, yes, Amitabh, you are absolutely right. There, what generally people do, people will do something. They will do review literature, frame some objectives, hypothesis, statistics, and then फटाफट रिसर्च हो गया, हाइपोथेसिस टेस्टिंग हो गया, और उसके कल्चर के बारे में हम कंक्लूजन भी ड्रॉ कर देंगे. अरे भाई, यू कैन नॉट अंडरस्टैंड, यू कैन नॉट स्टडी ए कल्चर ऑफ एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बाय कंस्ट्रक्टिंग ए क्वेश्चनेयर विद लिमिटेड नंबर ऑफ क्वेश्चंस. यू आर बिल्डिंग क्वेश्चनेयर फ्रॉम योर पर्सपेक्टिव, योर अंडरस्टैंडिंग, योर नॉलेज, योर पर्सपेक्टिव. If I do not understand their culture, if I do not do an ethnographic study, how do I understand, how do I identify different factors, different variables? The variables I cannot harvest from review literature here. The variables are not the foreign, alien. The variables are to be harvested from their life, from their work life, from their organization, from by interacting with them, by talking to them. And then when I build a theory, a beautiful description I develop to understand their culture, and there that will lead me for my further process, that is quantitative process, because I have to submit a report to the organization. What is the report? Conclusion, and then what to do as a researcher, as a consultant, I have to give some recommendations. I cannot finish my research, qualitative research, and submit a report. They may not understand. A practitioner, a doctor, a clinical psychologist, a social scientist can understand how to intervene, how to deal with people, okay. But a company will take policy, democratic principle, majoritarian principle, utilitarianism. Okay, utilitarianism. What is utilitarianism? That majority principle. If the majority people do something, say something good, it is good for the organization. Clear? So the third topic, we'll do qualitative research. We develop the understanding about the culture. And then if the company asks me, no, you have to give me some recommendations about what we should do in terms of policy formulation, then you have to carry forward. You have to go to the next stage, that is deductive method or descriptive research or statistical analysis, empirical design. And then you have to draw a conclusion. When you draw a conclusion, you can give recommendations. Else you cannot. So it is exactly 5, because Dayashankar told me to complete in 2 hours and then half an hour for question answer. So what I wanted to talk to all of you, just my objective was to sensitize you about the importance of mixed method research and what is mixed method research, what are the limitations of deductive method, what are the limitations of inductive method. So it is a question of, minimizing the drawbacks by identifying a beautiful combination or using more than 2 methods of research. So this is mixed method. What is mixed? When qualitative and quantitative are used, okay, together, it is mixed. If I am using more than 2 or more than 1 qualitative research, then it is multiple research method. So multiple research method and mixed method research are different. Now, one thing you tell me, please, let me know. Please tell me the difference between, is it okay, all of you, or are you feeling bored? No, sir is only talking and we are listening. Because there is no response. And I think Aparajita had a question, but she didn't ask me.
Yeah, sir, I was just waiting for you to continue.
Okay, just I am giving one more question. You listen to it and then you ask me your question. I'll respond and then go back to my question.
Okay.
what is the difference between research question, investigative question, and measurement question? I have asked it in several PhD interviews. Excellent scholar, beautifully done research, beautiful thesis. But whenever I have asked the question, please tell me the difference between a research question, an investigative question, and a measurement question. No answer. They say, do not know. And they are doing PhD. And they will join some universities and departments and they will teach students. So dangerous. Okay, this question will answer. First, you ask me your question, Aparajita. Anyone can ask question now, this 15-20 minutes. If you have the energy to sit up to 5:30, I have no problem, but at least there must be some couple of questions so that we can discuss.
Yeah, thank you, sir. My question is related to inductive and deductive reasoning. So in those two slides, you have shown these diagrams.
I'm going there. You continue your question.
Yeah. So primarily these two structures look linear in nature. When you discussed about the inductive method, it appeared to me that it is actually not linear. Or you can correct me if I'm wrong. So for example, if at the observation stage I find that from my observations I'm not able to derive any pattern. So if I follow this linear structure, I may reach to a non-conclusive theory or no theory at all.
Right.
But
yes.
If I follow a non-linear structure, then probably I will come back to exploration or even to the assumption and realign my assumption to find some pattern. So I'm trying to think that when you said that the moral question behind any research work should be, particularly in social science, that whether you're contributing anything or not, then probably a non-linear structure suits better, according to my understanding. So your view on this, sir?
Yeah, I am giving my views here. I am very happy that you have really raised a very beautiful question and you have framed the question very nicely. It shows that you are very much sound intellectually. What I would say, whatever I have presented in PPT, that's an indicative model. That's an indicative model to understand the crux of inductive method. And to, because if I cannot create a picture, I cannot compare. So when we are sitting here and engaging ourselves in a discourse, so we need to see something which is visual. So visuals have better impact in understanding, in building, you know, in doing analysis. So I had to create some model, I have to create some indicative model so that a common man, a general researcher, can compare inductive and deductive and can understand the basic differences. As you have rightly said, that's why I used the word triangulation in qualitative research. Triangulation is very, very important and needed. So triangulation does not support linear concept or any linear view. It does not support any linear view. And a qualitative research definitely cannot go linear. You are 100% correct. So that's why we have to use the concept of triangulation, cross-verification. Somewhere I go and stuck, find out other alternatives, how that is to be possible, how can I understand, how can I know about the life of those people? So I start talking to friends, relatives, and so many things. And gradually I can reach some more close references. And ultimately I reach my subject, the respondent. So this happens. That's why qualitative research is full of challenges. It is not very smooth process. Every step you have to struggle. Very good question. So I think I could have answered you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question? This is indeed was a very good question from Abhrajita. Any other question from other scholars, other faculty members? Mr. Amitabh?
Yes, sir. I have a small question. Is it that, sir, the quantitative or statistical tools of research are more effective in Western or developing countries due to their higher level of education and more sophistication in terms of data capturing, data gathering, etc.? Is it somehow, sir, related to that?
I tell you one thing. See, as a researcher, we are not telling that statistical method, empirical method is not effective. Definitely effective. They have their own scope. So when the government of India is going to adopt now, because the National Education Policy 1986 and National Education Policy 2020, if you just do a comparative analysis, you'll find a lot of difference. This 2020 National Educational Policy has a lot of qualitative input. Qualitative development has been grossly addressed in the new education policy. Understand? So a very different subject. So you can compare as a faculty member, as a researcher, you can do a study on it. But what I'm saying, when we are going to take a decision on a 100 crore population, okay, we have to use. Now here I just give a contra view. Census of India, what they do, it is a census study, it is not research.
Right.
It is a census study. We cannot use the word census survey. No, never we can use the word survey here. Census study. Each and every family is included. Why each and every family is included? Why government can do sampling? The planning commission, and now it is Niti Aayog, they can do sampling. 100 crore population will take 2 lakh sample and do. No. So to understand a comprehensive view about the entire population of India, each and every family is included in the census. So deductive research based on majoritarian principle, so help us to draw some generalized observation or conclusion. That is also okay. But what is it? It means that you are following utilitarian principle. That means if my action can create benefit to the maximum number of people, so my result justifies my action. Output is the determinant of your merit, not the process. Okay? So, but now, for example, if the government wants to know, why do people not use mask properly? Tell me. Everybody is having a mask on their face, you will see. Full hanging, half hanging, it is on chin, it is on cheek, it is on nose, it is on forehead. Okay, somebody has their mask and they are keeping it in pocket. Whenever police ask them, they say, sir, I have it in my pocket. So whenever I come in contact of somebody, I'll use it. So if government wants to know why this mask, using a mask is not being effective among certain sections of people, tell me how you'll go ahead. Will you do a survey? No, survey cannot give you insight. So you have to engage yourself. You have to sit with a group of people and you have to engage with them. A detailed conversation. Bhai, batao kya problem hai? Kya hai? Inka look kharaf hai? Ya inka vajan kharaf hai? Ya shape kharaf hai? Design kharaf hai? Kya hai? या आप जो पेरेंट्स के पास जाते हो पहनते हो, दोस्तों के पास जाते हो पहनते हो, और किसी के पास जाते हो नहीं पहनते हो, व्हाट इज द सिचुएशन? की हो है আপনাদের মনে? কেন আপনারা পড়েন না, ইউজ করেন না? তাহলে আমাকে এখানে কিন্তু আই হ্যাভ টু এনগেজ মাইসেলফ উইথ এ কোয়ালিটেটিভ রিসার্চ, ইন ডেপথ অ্যানালিসিস, ন্যারেটিভ স্টাডি, वो मास्क का यूज उनके वर्ड्स माने उनके शब्दों में हमको जानना पड़ेगा, वो क्या सोचते हैं इसके बारे में, हम क्या सोचते हैं ये इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है, वो लोग क्या सोचते हैं मास्क के बारे में वो सोचते हैं, वो देखते हैं पहले हाउ डू पीपल थिंक अबाउट द मास्क। ये किसी ने कोशिश नहीं किया, वो आया कोविड आया हम बोल दिए कि मास्क पढ़ो पहनो, पर हमने ये नहीं कोशिश किया कि हाउ डू पीपल विजुअलाइज मास्क, वेदर इट इज ए प्रोटेक्टिव डिवाइस और ए फैशन डिवाइस और समथिंग व्हिच एवरीबॉडी इज यूजिंग सो आई एम यूजिंग। सो डेफिनेटली आई डू नॉट नो व्हाट क्वेश्चंस टू बी आस्क्ड टू अंडरस्टैंड पीपल्स बिहेवियर अबाउट मास्क। So I have
to understand their awareness levels also. What is the
understanding? So here you have to engage with them in a qualitative research, narrative research, group discussion, focus group discussion, long conversation, not question answer, not response, not survey. Understand?
Yes.
You have to just simply go and talk to them, sitting with them, and then using a beautiful conversation, rapport building, and then gradually you have to go inside their mind to understand conscious mind, subconscious mind, unconscious mind. And then you will actually understand why do an average Indian fails to use a mask. I think I could answer your question, Amita.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, any other question? Mr. Ashish Saha, there is one person from Lucknow. No other question. If you have no other question, then I'll hand over this session to Daya Shankar. I hope all of you understand the question what I raised, research question, investigative question, and measurement question. Research question. What is the problem? What is the problem? Okay? What is the problem? Research question. So when, if, until, unless this question is solved, you have to do qualitative research. If you have the answer, then you can go into descriptive research or quantitative research or empirical study, you can do, no issue. But if the problem itself is not known, I do not know. What is the problem? 4 lakh, one day 4 lakh people. 4,072 deaths in last 24 hours and 4,13,000 or 12,000 people affected. What is happening? There are experts sitting and doing mathematical modeling. A lot of calculations going on. Every time the mathematical model fails, all big shots are sitting in labs and they are giving advices to PMO. What is happening? Nothing is happening. And this is not a time that at micro level about a million researchers can involve themselves and do some qualitative research, because this kind of infrastructure we do not have in terms of IT and all, so that we can well coordinate and do some qualitative research at different points and then collaborate the findings and then consolidate and find out a concrete understanding. The actual scenario of India, why it is happening so that mechanism, that infrastructure we don't have. America can do, only 33 crore population, larger land size, geophysical space is much bigger than India has, and we are 133 crore. Not possible. Sometimes we are emotionally charged and blame some government and this government and that government. Any other question, Mr. Vivek Kumaran? Those who I can see on my screen, I am taking their name. There are many other 26 participants are there.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
I'm Sharmila Banerjee.
Yes.
I want to say that some problems are there, research problems, which is fixed for doing either quantitative or qualitative. We can't do both. Like measuring the achievement of students. In that case, quantitative will be better.
Yes. Yeah, simple. COPO analysis.
Yes.
Okay, conducting examination and then percentage calculation, all quantitative methods. But if you want to do an analysis of character building, role of education in character building, you cannot directly go into quantitative method or descriptive research. Understand?
Yes.
Yeah, John, you have to, because you do not know how it is impacting their character. I do not know how it is impacting their character. So you have to engage, you have to use some qualitative method, okay? And then you have to do narrative study, narrative research. And then you have to build a theory, hypothesis. And then you can go for, empirical research. You can take a large number of sample and see whether your information, whatever you have retrieved and whatever variables and factors you have harvested, or you have, evolved, whether these are actually helping you to go for some generalized statement, generalized conclusions. Is there any other question? If no,